Okay. So it's 4:40. I know your brain is getting tired, isn't it? It's a little different from what we did on Monday, right? It was more about ideation. So I think your right brain was more active on Monday. Now today, it's like your right brain and left brain is like going back and forth, right? And then maybe when you're thinking about relationship and elements, it's more about your left brain, right? So now I think you're getting more tired. So who said who slept well? Was it Nobi? Yeah, right. You will sleep better tonight. Oh, okay. So this is your more comfortable, are you? Okay. So Sarisa, you probably sleep better tonight. Yes. She's from arts department. So, okay, good. But I want you to become both comfortable. And tomorrow you'll become business comfortable. So right. You know, basically we're asking you to become a Superman. So, yay. All right. So, third viewpoint. We will talk about value chain viewpoint. Okay, value chain viewpoint. And then the elements we'll see here will be stakeholders and their values. These are the elements and then the relationship we will be looking at. Okay, so customer value chain analysis is, we call it CVCA. Okay, we call it CVCA. And in Japanese, it's 顧客価値連鎖分析. It sounds scary, doesn't it? So we just call it CVCA. And it's a value chain viewpoint, and then the stakeholders and other their values are represented. So it kind of looks like this. It's a pretty diagram. And so it's another diagram. It kind of looks like causal link, but now we're looking at not the cause and effect, but the values, okay? Here. So CVCA can clarify who are the stakeholders, how does value flow in between stakeholders, and how does material or energy or goods flow? How does information flow? Who are you designing for? Or who are your important customers are? These are things that we can discuss on CVCA or while drawing CVCA. And this is what it looks like. Electrocardiographic monitor. So it looks after your heart. Okay. And then, so this is a simple CVCA that is introduced in the book written by Ishii Sensei. And so I will just use this as an example, and I'm not going to get into this example. I will get into a more different example because that's more easy to understand. But I will use this to show you the steps. There are only three steps to draw CVCA. Okay, one, you start listing up stakeholders. Stakeholders are customers, partners, organization, for standards, and etc. So when you say stakeholders, I think some of you have an impression of stakeholder equals customer. No? Yeah, I guess some of you does. But it's not, right? You, as a designer, you are a part of stakeholders, okay? Stakeholder is not only customers, but it includes your boss, you, and your partner company, and your alliance company, and everybody else, all right? And then the customer is part of your stakeholders, okay? Don't get confused. So customer is part of stakeholders, but stakeholders consist of customers and many other related people, all right? Good. So you list up stakeholders, and then you identify value between stakeholders and how it's flow. And then so dollar sign or yen sign for money or capital, icons for product, service, and information, and then exclamation mark for claims and regulations. So that's the ground rules. But this is according to the book. I'm not going to be strict on the rules. It's just a general guideline, okay? And after you've drawn all these arrows and icons and stakeholders, you now perform analysis. Who is important customers? Trace dollars and exclamation mark. And then what is a value for stakeholders, each stakeholders? Change from input to output. And then are they satisfied? Are they seems to satisfied? Are they balanced? And things like this. And identify negative effect. Who may have a big negative effect on the whole value chain? That's the analysis you perform. So, for example, this case. So Hewlett Packard created this machine so that it can help doctors, okay? So it kind of does some part of diagnosis on the heart disease. So you put it, you give it to, this is a device, you give it to a patient. Patient is broken arm and broken leg, so it's not a heart disease, but he's supposed to have a heart disease and not the broken leg and arm, but okay, he has a heart disease that, so that this this was the kit or the device that gives the, that goes to patient, and patient, this device will tell information to the doctor so the doctor are easily can easily conduct the diagnosis on a certain disease. So that was the concept. And Hewlett Packard, the intention of Hewlett Packard was they wanted to sell their laptop and printer and every peripherals around this device. That was the idea. But doctor had to pay for this, right? Doctor had to make a request for that. And then doctor was not getting any money from the patient. So that was the basic initial idea. And doctor saying, hey, okay, my money goes out. And who is paying for that? Nobody is. So that was the first idea. So this Hewlett Packard, and then this is actually, again, at the Stanford Ishii-sensei, they have talked, and then, okay, we should talk to insurance company so that insurance company can reimburse or pay for this device. And then to be able to do so, we need to have a government acceptance of insuring, you know, covering this device by the insurance. So this is the structure that they needed. So this is some analysis and some design that they tried. So here's a vending machine example. I'm sorry, I didn't have the original file, so I couldn't change the Japanese here on this slide, but I think the picture will explain to you. So this is you, customer, or the consumer, and this is the location owner who sets the vending machine. So you get the bottle, of course, right? You get the bottle with the liquid, and then you pay, but you're not actually paying the location owner. Location owner is, as it named, it is just the location owner. He doesn't own the vending machine. Vending machine is actually owned by vending machine operator. So you're paying not to the location owner, but to the vending operator. And then vending operator gives the location owner the vending machine and then the bottles. And did you know, this vending machine operator pays location owner for the place. これ、場所代払ってるんですね、実は。電気代も払ってます。 They even pay for electricity to run the vending machine at the location. So, yeah, you should become a location owner if you have a spare space around your house. It's okay. And then location owner, of course, have some requests and comments to the vending machine operator. And then this is the vending machine manufacturer, and this is a bottling company. And vending machine manufacturer will provide a vending operator with a vending machine, and then bottling company will provide a vending operator with a bottled liquid or bottled drinks. And of course, there's a business deal in between them. And of course, bottling this standard, and then the regulation goes to this vending machine manufacturing. And then there is a Coca-Cola or whatever the drink company, and they provide with the the liquid or the drink, and then they bottle, and then they operate. So this is what it looks like, okay? But this is very much the supply chain, right? Supply chain. We're just looking at money, product, and service. That's not the only value we want to picture or we want to draw in a value chain. Here is a CVCA. We do it for our class in SDM. And SDM is not kindergarten, we are graduate school, but we use Momotaro folktale for CVCA, right? You did this, right? SDM student, you did this. So here is your stakeholders. Again, this is in Japanese, but you can see the faces, right? Okay, so for non-Japanese people, Momotaro is a folktale. This little guy, he's like a samurai guy, okay? I guess. I may sound stupid, but he was born from a peach. Yes, one day, So now I'm telling the story. Yes. So one day he came in, you know, came out of the peach, big peach, not the little peach, that's a big peach. Okay. And then this grandma and grandpa, they fostered him, and then he became a really strong man. And then one day he found out this evil devils are beating up the towns and the villages. So he decided to go to make it fix, right? So, and then he finds his friends. Yeah, okay, I need to do this. Bird, monkey, and then doggy, okay? This is his friend, helped him to beat the evil devil. So that's the story. And then, so here's the value chain we're talking about. So the reason why I do this is that I don't want you to be focusing only on money and capitals and goods, okay? Because there are different values exchanged by different stakeholders. Different stakeholder appreciates different values. That's what I want you to try to imagine. So their grandpa and grandma or their foster parents, they heard that Momotaro, this is Momotaro. Momo means peach and Taro means a boy, so peach boy. Yes, basically this peach boy. He says, "Okay, I need to do this. You know, I'm so pumped up. I need to go beat them up." All right? And then they said, "Okay, be careful, but I'll give you this special kind of what is it? Dango?" Yeah, okay, kibidango. It's a rice cake. It's a power rice cake. Okay? Well, I think I'm doing the best job I can do. So, yeah, it's a power rice cake, okay, so that he gets more energy. And, yeah, energy ball. What's that? Ah, energy ball, yes. Right, energy ball, okay. And then this Momotaro goes on a trip, and then he finds his friends on the way, and then these friends are participating, and then he gave these friends or his colleagues or... Right, colleagues, the energy ball, okay? Now they're a team to go fight against the evil guys, and then this is what they're aiming for. They want to get back all the treasures and then the money that they took. So, but what is the value these guys are getting? None, they're just getting beaten up. So we can say they get good heart, right? They gain good heart. That's value for these evil spirits, right? They gain good heart. Okay, so, and here comes the villagers, okay? Villagers, they were taken. These treasures were abducted by the evils. So the story must finish that Momotaro and his colleagues, his buddies, beat them up and then get the treasure back and give it back to the people, and people will appreciate. Ta-da! Yes! Customer value chain. But did you know there are so many versions of Momotaro out there? What's that? You didn't know? Yeah, there are different versions of Momotaro, and many versions of them, that at the end of the story, Momotaro beats up the evils and then say, and the evil say, "Hey, these are all the treasures we took from the villagers. I will give it back to you." And Momotaro say, "No, I don't need that. But I will get the princess." So princess was also taken. So I will just rescue her and I'll go home. Uh-oh. So where did that go? He has to do this. He can be a cool guy saying, "Hey, I don't need no money. But I will just rescue her." That's not good, okay? Because now he's messing up all the value chain. So Momotaro, is he really a good guy? That's a discussion you can do overnight, okay? So what I wanted to say is that don't just focus on the values of money and capital, okay? Different stakeholders appreciate different values. I want you to try to focus that. So, okay. Now, discuss and create CVCA of one of your concept or ideas. If you don't have, you can do wearable lifelong device. But keep on the topic, okay? Keep on the topic. And consider the values that are not only money and good or service, all right? So who are main stakeholders? Don't list up like 100 stakeholders. Don't. Okay, you want to keep your eye on the main ones. So be careful. Be careful not to bring everybody on the board. Okay, you want to focus on your very important ones. And what are values for the stakeholders? Okay, each stakeholder appreciates different values, all right? So value, the sense of value is not absolute. It's all relevant. It's all relevant. Everybody appreciates different things. Everybody likes different things. So you need to think about that. And then how is the value chained? Okay, I'll give you an example. So, okay, souvenir from Hiroshima for my family, CVCA. Okay, Hiroshima Station, it's me, Dad. I bought Momiji Manju. You know Momiji Manju? Yeah? It's a power energy ball. No. It's another, the rice cake. It's a very Hiroshima famous souvenir. All right? And it's good. And so I buy this, right? And so if I just draw supply chain, that's it, right? This does not exist. It doesn't matter if I just draw a supply chain. I got the goods, I pay the money, that's it. However, I get more value after I pay this. Now I get home, and I give my daughter this Momiji Manju. And it has an interesting shape like this. It has a shape of the leaf. So my daughter will ask me, hey, Dad, what is Momiji Manju? Why is it shaped like this? Then I can tell her story of Momiji Manju. And we get conversations, and that's a great value for me, right? And then I give it to her mom, my wife, and so that she will say, oh, so you went to Hiroshima, how was it? We get the conversation. So this is a value for me. So this is supply chain, but this is the actual value I gained. So I want you to try to focus on this area. And then this is often in Japanese called fukakachi, right? Not only the supply chain, so this is the value that we want to focus. And in the design process like this, you of course want to focus here. Right? Who's appreciating what? And what are you providing them with? So different scenes, different people will appreciate different stuff. So here's what I want you to do. Visualize a value chain so you can discuss. Later on, you can discuss, modify, and make it as part of innovative solution. You want to make this as a part of innovative solution, that your value chain. You want to have good value chain that many stakeholders appreciate. And of course, your main customer wants to appreciate. Okay, so stick on the topic that you are working on and then create the value chain, CVCA, okay? So you have to be somewhat logical, somewhat creative, and somewhat, fun, and just have fun, okay? All right, so I know you have a lot of paper now produced. If you can find a place, you can put it up on the wall or on the whiteboard if you want to. All right, start working. I'll give you about 20 minutes.
Thank you.
So I gave each team a whiteboard, so you can hand up the papers you produced earlier. Okay? You can put up the papers you produced earlier so that you can see how you're doing this. ホワイトボードあげたので、そこにマイクってやつ貼って、で、見えるようにしながら新聞紙書くと結構いい。せっかく他のビューポイントから作ったやつがあるので、その見えるようにしながら、このチーム人、あの、紙じゃない、紙じゃない、ホワイトボードがやってるので、せっかくなんで他の視点から見たやつを貼っといて議論すると
お父さんにお父さんがお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さんにお父さ
So try to keep it simple. Keep with the essential parts, okay? Essential elements, only essential elements.
ありがとうございます。 そしたらファミリーが生きていくことないじゃないですか。
誰も出てきませんね。誰も出てきませんね。僕もファミリーってフレンドがなんか
Okay, one comment. I see many teams are working just okay. Okay, one comment. So, is your CVCA, is your CVCA and your Coastal League, are they related? Again, causal loop diagram, right? Causal loop diagram. If you are working on the same topic, this is a condition. If you are working on the same topic, is your causal loop diagram and CVCA related? What do you think? Of course it is, right? Of course, because you're looking at the same thing but from a different viewpoint. So if you are still on the same topic, your CVCA and causal link has some kind of relationship. Okay? Think about that. Think about that. Not direct relationship, but there is a relationship. So please, if you are still working on the same topic when you draw a causal loop diagram, please take a look side by side. Causal loop diagram and then CVCA. You are still working on the same topic and from a different viewpoint. Okay, you can continue on.
ですね。
Okay, I see many of you have somewhat completed a CVCA, so let's do the same old, same old. So, insight, right? You have discussed
your idea from a value chain viewpoint. What are insights? What the new thing you found? What could be the insight to drive your solution? Or what could be a new question it arose to you?
Oh.
Attractive, I mean slender.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. In Japanese, it's a
kasamashi dish, kasamashi shoki. Yeah. Really. And first, we discuss about stakeholders. There are some stakeholders like dish shop or father, mother, and or boyfriend. Yeah, her friend. She's she.
Okay.
Yeah. And there is a very bad boss. Bad woman.
In
boss.
Other words, otsubone joshi.
Otsubone joshi.
Yes.
Yes. And firstly, if
she uses the dish, she will get slender, and it makes her boyfriend buy new dress.
Disagree.
Yeah, and disagree.
You hope.
Oh, yes, okay, yes.
Yeah. Anyway, and yeah, and her boyfriend will like her more and more. Yeah. And her friend will see her being very attractive and slender, and then her friend will buy the other one, other dishes, and yeah, of course, yeah, they pay money to the dish shop, yeah. And then her father also take care of his health, so her father will buy it, and actually, he will be anxious about their relationship because their relationship will get strong.
Now yeah? The story is evolving, okay?
Evolving.
Yes.
Yeah. And yeah, we think it's interesting because her father want to use the dishes by himself, but he is anxious about the uses of for her, yeah. And actually, we found one thing. She will get less weight, and she will not go to the gym anymore. And actually, most women. And yeah, her boss will bully her. Okay. Yeah. And
because she's getting too pretty?
Yes, it's too pretty. But actually she will buy the dishes.
Okay.
And
now the story is more developing.
Yeah, actually
okay. What's the outcome of the CVCA you gained? I saw the output. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So with these stories, we found some things, and the most interesting one is maybe but the buyer of mm-hmm. dishes can be someone who hope user to get slender. For example, my boyfriend, maybe he hope me to get to be slender. So
okay.
Perhaps the maker can market it to my boyfriend.
Not the user, but the buyer. Yeah. And user might be different.
Yeah.
Okay, interesting point. Okay, yes. Well, yeah, okay, I think this is a hypothesis, kind of, right? This is like you guess maybe this may happen. Now you can maybe start doing like observation. Okay, you start going to Akari's house and see whether if her dad really cares about her, or if dad, does he really eat dinner with her, or does he really buy a dish himself, or is it really his wife that buys a dish for the family? So you can do a lot of observation or research whether if this any of this is true, or if there anything that you need to update on, right? So, but this gives you a good start to think about the like a very primitive business model, right? Very primitive, okay? You don't know how much, you don't know how many, but this is the entry point for tomorrow, okay? This is the entry point for tomorrow. This will get you to the unit economics. Unit economics is a price of a product or service, per service or per product. So for example, now, okay, so we are concerned that, so how much this dish may be, how much? And then, okay, this will be purchased by individual who has a high concern on health, maybe, or this could be presented by somebody who is concerned on some user's health status, right? So
So this is not the regular dish. This will help them to become healthy. So this could be a little bit more expensive than the dish, regular dish, because it has more functionality. That's what you can claim. So now you start thinking how much this may be per product or per service. So CVCA is a great entry point to start thinking about the unit economics. I think you can look at your CVCA and kind of see how your business model might start, right? So please take a photograph of this, because we will going to use it tomorrow. We're going to use this to start calculating the unit economics and then the marketability, and hopefully just a little bit of discussion on the profitability. So CVCA is actually going to connect your value proposition into business model or business synthesis. So CVCA, getting the right CVCA or getting the confident and well-thought CVCA is a key for entry point to start thinking about the business model, okay? So I think it's a primitive version of your future business, okay? Good, thank you very much. Okay, now I want to clear the sight of the people just a little bit, thank you. Okay, one last segment. So now we have been talking about different views, and now we're at the final portion of this. Where is my file? There we go. So the fourth viewpoint is function and physical architecture. Now we have discussed purpose and alternative ideas, cause and effect, value chain, and function and physical viewpoints. This is straight from the systems engineering, so it might be a little tricky for some of you, but yeah, don't worry, so it's going to be all right. So now I want to introduce you to with a concept and then the word called architecture. I know we have some architecture guy. Who is my architecture people? Yes, you are. Architecture, not the system architecture, but architecture. Yes, right. Yes, you are too, right? SFC people we have architect. So this is like building architecture. That's often called architecture. But for geeky people from Rikogakubu, your architecture is this, right? But both definitions are narrow from our standpoint. So when we say system architecture, it means the elements and then how they are interrelated and then the abstraction description of their element relationship. So I will explain that later on, but I'm going to define the architecture. Before getting into that, we're going to do a quiz. Which of the following have the same architecture? Anyone? Non-SDM people. Yuki, slow down. You know the answer. Okay, Akari, come on. Tennis and volleyball, how come? Mm-hmm. Okay, they're against each other over the net. Okay, good. All right, Kai.
Volleyball and soccer are correlated because there are intermediaries between the person who play.
Yeah.
Cycle variable,
yeah.
And the ball.
Okay, so person and the ball directly interact with each other. Okay. Any other opinion? Which of the following has the same architecture?
Baseball,
yes.
Baseball and tennis.
Which one?
Baseball
and tennis. Why?
They have tools.
They have tools. Yes. Okay. Anything else? Okay, SDM people, your turn. Yes.
Baseball and volleyball and soccer is the same thing.
Baseball and volleyball and soccer, why?
Because so it is a team sport.
Okay, what about the doubles? Oh. See, I'm not easy on SDM people. Okay, come on, SDM people, fight with me. Okay. Okay, you keep.
I think maybe baseball and tennis and volleyball are thin architecture. Because we don't know when it finishes.
Okay. So this has a time limit.
Yeah.
These are time limit less. Good point, yes. Okay, good job.
All sports are is playing on the ground.
Okay. So you mean?
Not in the water.
Ah, okay. They're on the soil. They're on the surface. Okay. Kazuki. Your turn. Boone, you're next.
Baseball?
Yes.
Tennis?
Yes.
And soccer?
Yes.
Is played on the glass.
On the glass?
Yes.
Okay.
The volleyball is in a in-house sport.
Okay.
So they,
it's on the floor?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Three use hand and one uses foot.
What about the goalie? All right. So, all right. I think you're all correct. You're all correct. You have described the architecture from different perspective.
Okay. So, different perspective gives you different understanding of architecture. Architecture, meaning the how elements are aligned. So, here's an example of an architectural description. Okay. I'm gonna focus on how human and then a ball interact. Okay. It's like. I guess it was Nobi. So architecture that human and a ball interact directly. These are two. Okay? So this is just an example. Okay? Architecture that human and a ball interact with a tool in between. So this is these two are so. I will describe in the model or diagram. Okay? So this is the rule, ground rule I will following. Physical element is in the box. Behavioral element is in the circle, and interrelationship in between will be in the arrow in orange. So human exert force through the ball, okay, and then ball flies. This is the how I can describe my architecture. So human is a physical element, and then the ball as a physical element, and then behavioral element, my human exerts force through the ball to fly, and then the ball flies. Right, and then the interrelationship in between is a force. Okay, so the other one, human exerts force to the tool, tool exerts force to the ball, and then the ball flies. So here, human tool ball exerts force to the tool to move, and then exerts force to the ball to fly, and then the ball flies, and then the force is interconnected. So now we can see there are two different architecture, right? Now it looks very different. So, I have changed to this. Okay, here, I'm changing this. Okay, so, okay, it's kind of goofy. Okay, I wanted to do this instead. Exert force the ball to run, roll on the ground. And, but this is, to read it so that it run, okay, the ball to roll. What is this? Human exert force the ball to roll on the ground, and then the ball rolls on the ground. What is this? What kind of sports is this? Bowling, yes. Or? Otama korogashi. Okay? Yes. And what about golf? There's a tool, and sometimes ball flies, so it's no, right? Good. So what about this? I'm going to change this architecture to shuttle. The shuttle. What is this? Badminton. Yes, this is obvious. So, you know, there are similar architecture. It's similar, but it's not exactly the same, but there are similar architecture. So this is how you look at architecture. So physical element, behavioral element, and then interconnection of them. So the definition of architecture we use in SDM often is the arrangement of function and feature that maximizes some objective.
Okay, this is said by Jack Ring. He's the famous guy in the system design, system engineering field. And then, or fundamental organization of a system embodied in its components, their relationship to each other, and to the environment, and the principle guiding its design and environment. So this is how it's defined in systems engineering field. Aren't you surprised that they do not talk about electronics, computers? They do not talk about like fancy words like interfaces. No, this is very generic, isn't it? Very generic. But this is how people in the world understand architecture. Okay, it's domain free. It's not talking about computer or electronics or anything, but it's just talking about components and relationship and principles. So it's more abstract. It can be applied to any field. So we have been talking about this all day long, right? Elements and their relationship. So basically what we have been talking about, you take system as a whole and you think as of them, their parts and their relationship. This is the architecture, okay? You think about the parts and relationship. It is the architecture. So here's an interesting representation from MIT. Who doesn't know MIT? Yes, good. So Massachusetts Institute of Technology and Engineering Systems Division, we have a class with together. So system architecture is an abstract description of the entities of a system and the relationship between these entities. See? This is what we've been talking about all day long, right? Parts and the whole and then the relationship. So architecture is something you know already. You have been drawing architecture over and over from different perspective, perspective. And I really like this diagram that I'll go with quick. So you have an architecture, right? Your system, every system has some kind of architecture. And if you make a decision on an architecture, then architecture has a great influence on function behavior, how your system behaves, okay? This is intended, this is designed, okay? You design function and it behaves. However, once you decide on architecture, your system will have an emergent behavior, something you did not expect, something you did not expect. This happens too. When I hear this, it always reminds me of nuclear power plant, right? It took certain architecture, right? It adopted certain architecture, and it functioned, it had function behavior, right? It served its purpose. However, once it got in trouble, we are fighting over emergent behavior. Emergent meaning sohatsu, something you did not expect. Something you did not expect when you design it. So once you decide on architecture, there are great influence on function behavior and then the emergent behavior. So you want to carefully to choose architecture so that it will not have a crazy emergent behavior. Agree? Agree. Okay. And of course, architecture has a great impact on the complexity of your system. And then the architecture has a great impact on the ilities. Ilities is an unfamiliar term for you probably, but it's about the operability, usability, all those ilities, right? It's a characteristic of a system or architecture that governs the system itself. So usability, operability, durability, maintenanceability, and things like this. All those ilities are greatly influenced by architecture. So you want to choose the architecture so that it suits your purpose, fits your purpose. If you want certain ilities, you need to be careful to choose your architecture. What kind of entities and entity relationship you choose does matter. Okay? Yes, go ahead.
How do you define the complexity
of the system? Good question. There are so many discussions going on right now, there is no one rule yet. We can talk about software system, there is a way to calculate this, but it's not defined. And then when we talk about system, like any system, we can't. So you can write PhD thesis on this. Yeah, it's still available, yes. Any other question? I know it's getting a little bit techy, but you know, it's still interesting, right? Still, it's so, it's a mindset, or it's still conceptual and not easy to understand. And this is something MIT people are saying, so it's really interesting. And
architecting is another term. It's easy, building architecture. It's basically building architecture. So you, when you say building architecture, it means you decide which entity you're talking about, and then you decide on the relationship. That's what you're doing. So definition of architecting is, could be said, allocate functions to elements and clarify the relation or interface between elements. So for example, okay, so this is a slide that I, okay, so okay, here's one function. Function to sting, or you know, stick your, penetrate, okay? Function to penetrate, and function to be held by hand. And then these two functions embedded on physical element of bamboo. Can you tell what this is? This is that, okay? So I can describe it, function to sting or penetrate, right? Sasu kino. And then function to be held, motareru kino. Okay? And then the physical element, bamboo. So this part has a function to penetrate, okay? This here, function to be held. So physical element, it's on the physical element of bamboo. This is how we can describe even like something like this as a system, okay? This is how we look at this. Physical, this is a physical element. There's only one physical element, but two functional elements. So now we are looking at our system, that thing, from two viewpoints, function and physical, okay? And then it can be represented like this, okay? This is how we can draw our diagram. So, architect, this is definition by Shirasaka sensei, relationship between system and its context and elements which constitute a system and the relations between these elements. So imagine this is the some kind of system. You have a function A and B, you have a function C, you have a function X and Y. And then these functions are realized by physical element 1, physical element 2, and physical element N. And then their interrelationship or interfaces are clarified like this. So example of a functional and physical architecture. So this could be described as a system, okay? From a physical and functional viewpoint. So architecting is allocating functions to elements and clarifying the relationship between elements. So we call it system design, right? System design management. What we do is actually architecting. This is what we do, okay? We define the functions, and then we try to allocate them to so that it works the best. Let's try. Okay, this is basic steps for architecting. Think what kind of functions are required, and then think physical elements which realize the functions. Okay, don't get scared, you'll be all right. You're in good hands of system engineers, so. All right? So, I'll show you some example. Architecture to share housekeeping tasks, okay? Consider my family. Functions to housekeeping is function to work in the kitchen, okay? Function to do washing, function to clean up rooms, and function to bring out garbage. Okay? This is the basic tasks to do housekeeping, okay? And physical element for my family, husband, me, and wife. And then I want to allocate these functions to the elements. Why are you laughing? Equal condition, of course. Look, I take care of function to do washing, which I don't. Function to bring out garbage, which I do. And then my wife does work function to work in the kitchen, function to clean up rooms, and function to take care of me. And the communication in between, we can call it architecture to share housekeeping. Okay, simple. All right. Architecture to cook simmered dish at well-established restaurant. Okay. Let's start from thinking about the functions. What are functions needed? Function to peel, function to cut, function to simmer, and function to flavor them, give it a flavor, and then function to arrange on a dish, and then function to serve. Agree? This is a function. And then here are my physical elements. junior apprentice, senior apprentice, and master. He's scary, okay? So I'm gonna allocate them. Then you need to think, you don't want your master to peel, right? He don't peel. Actually, he does just a little bit of the task. We'll see, okay? So function to peel, of course, is a junior apprentice. Apprentice is deshi, yes? Okay, function to peel, and then function to cut, and then you give it to pre-cooked vegetable. Now, not pre-cooked, but prepared. It's peeled and cut, so it's a cut vegetable, I'm sorry. It's cut vegetable, and then you pass it on to, not physically, but logically, you pass it on to senior apprentice, right? And then he does function to simmer. It simmers. And then simmered vegetables. Now it's kind of pre-cooked. And then the master takes care of the flavoring. Yeah? Now it's flavored. It's cooked vegetables, right? Now it's flavored and cooked vegetables. Now the senior apprentice arranges, and then he give it arranged cooked vegetable to the junior apprentice. Function to set the table. Yeah? So now we got architecture to cook simmered dish at well-established restaurant. Seems easy. This is systems engineering, actually. Wow. Okay, here comes your turn. Think functions which you need for your solution or idea based on based on what you've been talking about. So we go step by step. Okay, write in the format function to do something. Okay, focus on the most important functions and be careful not to get into too much detail. All right. So I'll show you an example. So this is what I want you to do now. Take a new sheet of paper. I need to tell you the truth. I asked somebody to translate this into English, and this is my first time looking at these slides. So it kind of sounds funny, but all of the slides I made, but okay. All right. So to support a person who is more than 60 years old to have motivated in life. Okay, we are going to think about the service to help the people who are more than 60 years old so that they can have a happier life. Okay, so that's the service that I'm thinking of. I will start thinking about the functions that we need. Okay, and when you think about function, don't think about how you're gonna realize this. Okay, forget about realization. Just forget it. But don't go to Doraemon field, okay? Don't go to impossible field, but just think purely about the function it's required. For example, so functions to understand person's character and then their skill set, okay? Skills or okay. Function to make proposal which meet the character and then the skill. So skill of the person who is more than 60 years old. And then you function to support the execution of the proposal. Okay, so this is the basic function maybe required. And I can continue the discussion and say function to prepare proposal patterns. Okay, and I can send it there. So these are functions we might need to fulfill this purpose, to support a person who is more than 60 years old. So that's what I want you to try. So I'll show you the Japanese version of this slide so that it's understood a little bit more. Okay, that's that. Oh, what? Yeah, we've been doing this all over Japan. This is from Hiroshima. there you go. Okay. So, here is the example. これ、日本語はね、60歳以上の人が生きがいを感じるサポートをするっていうのが日本語なんですよ。okay? Nice try. So, the 機能は、その人の特性や特技を把握する機能。この60歳以上の人のね。ほんで、で、性格や特技に合った提案をする機能。で、シニアサービスみたいなやつをこうサポートするサービスを考えて。で提案の実行を支援応援する機能ですとこういうのがあれば60歳以上の人が生きがいを感じるサポートをするっていうのができるかなと思ったわけですねほんで でもこれだけではちょっとあれだなと思ったので、性格や特技に合った提案をする機能っていうのがあるといいなと思って、提案のパターンを用意する機能があれば、これがうまくいけば60歳以上の人が生きがいを感じるサポートができるなと思ったってこと。 OK? So I don't know how I can realize this is exactly the same as the English version. So、I don't know how I realize these functions, but I know what functions are needed. So this is what I want you to try. I'll give you some time. I know it's already 6, so this is the last part, so I'll be quick. But I want you to try to think about the functions needed for your solution, okay? I don't care what part of the solution you look at. If your solution is a product, then maybe you need to think about something around the product. But if your service or idea is some kind of service, then you can probably think about this function flow, okay? So, okay, don't make it like a 20 function. Just let's keep it simple, but try to design your function for your concept and idea, okay? All right, you can start. I know this is kind of hard, so we can come and help you, all right? Or SDM people are there so to support, so. Oh, one thing. When you write function, please write whatever function, okay? And do not write all kanji function, like 中国語みたいな function, no. Okay, please write do whatever ing function or 何々する function, because that's more easy to understand. If it's all 特徴把握機能, no. It's cold, yes. All right, so keep it that way. And then in English, it's the same. In English, you want to keep in ing form. You want to keep in an ing form, it's so it's easy to understand. And then call it functions, okay? All right, go ahead and start.
Only functions. This is you designing functions for your idea. Okay? This is you designing function for your idea.
まず終わりです。わかります。こういう打ちやすさ。やはりこのお茶碗ですよね。
Get the high level abstraction function. Okay? High level abstraction function. I don't need detailed function, but I want high level abstraction function. Okay? And please do not consider the realization yet. Okay? But have it good functions. Flow of functions. And connect it with arrows.
ああ、そうだよねっていう理由が。 全てを出さない。
Okay, how are we doing on function design? Do you have something on the board? Yes, at least? Good. Now, I want you to do this. So, now you know your function, I want you to think about the physics. Okay? So, it's still the same. I lost my. Okay. Alright. This is the same functional element, right? Now, I want to think about the physical element. Here's what I do. I draw a rectangle or circle around it and call it, that's my physics. So, for example, my new company will do this function and this function. Okay? I will make my new company realize these two functions. And I think, function to prepare proposal patterns. I will ask municipal office to do this. This is a government, because it's too much work if I do it at my company. Function to understand a person, so this is a person 60 years old, character and their skills. Who should I make do this? Maybe I can do it with my new company, but how about a junior high school or high school student to do this for us? Okay? So now I have allocated functions to different physicals. And then here we can say we got the architecture of physics and function. And then we know the junior high school students and a new company has to have interface.
and then municipal office, and then the new company has to have an interface. Does the municipal office and then junior high school student has to have an interface? No, because there is no function connected. All right, so we know that. Based on these functional design, where we know who needs to have or where is an interface. All right, so I'm going to do a quick version of Japanese. There. さっきと同じ機能があって、この性格や特技に合った提案をする機能とか、その実行支援する機能は新会社でやろうと。で、この提案のパターンを用意する機能は、何やら個人情報とか何やらいろいろあるだろうから、じゃあ市役所などの行政にお願いをしちゃおうかなと。で、この特性や特技を把握するっていうのは、なんか自分たちでやるとめっちゃ大変なので、なんか子供たちに手伝ってもらって、 で、この情報を集めて、その情報を会社がもらってやったらどうだろうかみたいな。例えばこんな感じ。で、そうすると、この機能を先に決めておいて、機能を先に決めておいて誰にやらせるかを決めると、自動的にここにインターフェースが出てくると。ね。この物理とこの物理とこの物理はどうインターフェースしなきゃいけないかってことが分かるということです。OK? According to function. Interesting, isn't it? So, this is what I want you to try to do. So now, think about how you can realize your functions with what physical element you need. What physical element you need for your solution or your idea to realize this. Okay? I'll give you another few minutes to talk about, and we'll ask some team to present. All right? Okay, go on.
これお茶碗、本社どんな形になるかわかんないけど、一応なんかお茶碗の形を持つわけですよ、最後。なんとなく。その形のどこにこの機能がいくかなみたいな、なんとなく見取り図を書いてます。 伝わらない。
なんとなくまだ分かんないけど、どういうデザインするかない？変ね。マジ？なんとなくまあこういう茶碗かなんかわからんけどね。具体的なのはこれから考えるけど、どの辺にこの機能があったら良さそうかなみたいな感じを矢印してる。これある意味1個の物理の上にあのほらあれと一緒、竹串と一緒。
そうそうそう、
あんな感じでしょ。あと最後1個のものじゃん、うん、これをかなんか例えばなんだろうね、美味しそうに見える機能がもしかしたらここでもいいかもね。いやそこじゃない、やっぱこ中のこのやっぱこの内側のさ、ここじゃねとかさ、どうしよう。いやでもこの縁に乗せたい。だちょっと抽象度は高いんだけど、これを若干デザインしてる感じ。だからデザイナーにはなれないけど、機能をどこに配置したいかっていうデザインができるんです。でこれをデザイナーに見せる。知らんよそんな。だってそれはもう目的にはちゃうんだよ。だからこれがアーキテクチャを設計する。で詳細はプロのデザイナーにお願いしてるから、ここにでもこの機能を、ここはこういう機能にしてこうしたいけど、どうやったら形になるまで相談すればデザイナーは口頭でわけわかんないことを伝えられるようにこの方がいいです。そんな感じ。
これもうちょっと大きく書いて貼っちゃいますか、ね、写
これを両方に矢印とか、
矢印とか、矢印とか、量とか中身の中身ですかね、ここでは